Philly got the funk.
Philadelphia. Translation, city of brotherly love and America's first capital. Historic seat for the establishment of independence, liberty, and all that jazz. Even got a legendary sound named after us. But to let the media tell it, in the late 80s, our city's voice was struck silent, save for a few notable exceptions. Then, in the 90s, a thunderbolt of sound struck eardrums round the globe. Neo-soul, they called it, a curious but widely accepted term. And once again, Philly found itself proclaimed as the capital city. What was happening here during those missing years to cause such a flood of talent to emerge from relative obscurity? Why has Philadelphia been its epicenter? And who really knows what neo-soul is anyway? We present an insider's look at Philadelphia's underground black arts aesthetic that grew too big to remain in the shadows, and offer some predictions on its future from those who continue to be the water bearers of this culture. Despite what the industry may purport to be true,
there's no such thing as neo-soul.
There's no such thing as neo-soul. There's no such thing as neo-soul.
Before we discuss the term neo-soul, we should at least attempt to define it.
Even from the inception, I never liked the term. None of my clients ever liked the term. And I can't honestly say I know a bunch of people who have. I mean, it's a music industry figment. It's something that people within the industry came up with, just like when they start differentiating between hip hop and rap. You know what I mean? Like, I still don't know the difference.
Yeah.
I don't know.
The term neo-soul, for me in particular, is an obvious marketing tool. I don't necessarily identify with I don't identify with that sound as being neo-soul. It's almost the opposite. I see that a lot of the artists that are considered neo-soul as digging into a tradition that's not as neo as some people might think. And not necessarily just digging into a tradition, but taking honor and respect and worshiping the roots of our music and participating in the continuation of that tradition. So to say it's something new is actually opposite of what I think people are doing consciously and unconsciously.
Actually, the whole neo-soul thing just reminds me of another chance to exploit something that has already been happening for a while. It's a name to me that doesn't mean a lot, because neo means new, and new soul is definitely not what this is all about. It's nothing new so much about the singing and the sounds that Jill Scott Music or Bilal or any of the other people that they refer to as neo soul are doing. I admit it's fresh. It's not like building the house over again, but it's like redecorating, you know.
Alright, here's the science, right? Neo is the main character from the Matrix. Soul is James Brown. If you mix Neo with James Brown, I think his skin would be a little darker. And I'm saying this to say, I don't know what neo-soul is. If you say bologna sandwich, I know what a bologna sandwich is. If you say neo-soul, new soul, I mean, everything is new when it first comes out. I mean, 20 years from now, will you still be calling it neo-soul, or is it just the kind of term you just lump things together in, you know? I call it neo-soul. We'll call it a bunker busting bomb.
But what's very interesting is if you ask most of the people that are considered to be pioneers of this neo-soul movement, the artists themselves, mm-hmm. they hate the title. Mm-hmm. And the reason why, and you know what we seek to explain in the film, is that when you speak of soul, soul is antiquity. So it cheapens it to call it new.
Right.
You know, when we're saying that something is soulful, the reason why it's important is because it speaks to something very deep and important inside you. Mm-hmm. And so we just want it to be soul or theater or dance or whatever else people want to consider their artwork to be. But to call it new just, you know, makes it seem somehow less significant.
I think we're all in this, you know, universally in a cycle, so to speak, you know what I mean? So things kind of come around, mm-hmm. you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. So, you know, what we're hearing, like what they call neo-soul is a soul to me, you know what I mean? And it's always been that way. And, you know, Philadelphia had a major part in the sound of R&B, mm-hmm. you know what I mean? So it makes sense that, you know, that spirit is still here in Philadelphia, you know what I mean? That these cats mm-hmm. are doing their thing. And, you know, I think, you know, because we, for lack of better understandings of how things may be all relative, people would need to have labels for things in order to accept them and kind of categorize them in that way.
Definitely.
So it may work for some people to say, is neo soul whatever, but at the same time, you know, it is that for that person, but really the truth of it is that it's been around for a long time and it's not, you know, it's kind of like, you know, when it's not in your world, once, you know, all of a sudden it's new.
So when we get folks today, mostly European, Caucasian, describing neo-soul, neo-soul, I guess neo meaning new and soul meaning the music, it's nothing new about the music. I mean, whether it's Jill Scott, whether it's music, whether it's D'Angelo, it doesn't matter who it is. These are people doing the same thing that Barry White did, that Marvin Gaye did, that Al Green did. So it was nothing new about what they did, nothing new about what these artists are doing. When you talk about neo-soul, I guess, I don't know what the media means by that, but I guess what they mean is that this is a kind of renaissance. These are now artists who are singing and are crooning and have talent and play instruments and can read music and write music. I guess that's what they're saying, but for me, it's nothing new about that. It's just the next generation carrying on what the earlier generation carried on.
I don't really feel anything about the term neo-soul. It's like African American, you know? I mean, you're black and you're from America. And okay, we can go into a bunch of different tirades about what the word black means, but at the end of the day, that's what most folks who see you are going to call you. At the end of the day, when you think about soul music, I mean, what's neo about it? It just happens to have been made yesterday. You know, when Marvin Gaye made it, they didn't call it neo. When whoever else made it and is making it, they didn't call it neo, but I guess with the whole media craze and the whole attention that's being paid to the marketability of blackness these days, you know, it's another subgenre that needs to be, you know, folks in the media need to be able to stick things in a cookie cutter. So neo-soul to me is, you know, a little diamond-shaped cookie that they, you know, just, okay, now he's did it. Oh, now look, she's doing it too. Oh, now these people in California are doing it. It ain't never been nowhere. It's always been here. It's just our generation bringing forth what we know. And it's the choice few folks within our generation that choose to sing rather than rhyme, or choose to play a live instrument rather than be a programmer. So it's a term that was created by some white folks at the end of the day. And you know, that's not to diss them for it, but that's what it is. You know, soul music is soul music is soul music. 1903, soul is soul. One of the most universally recession-proof things in the world.
Kadar Massey, if you don't know who he is, he's a gentleman that's behind, I believe, D'Angelo, Erykah Badu, Inti Ivory. He's also a lawyer. I commend his efforts. And the lawyer in him, since he knew he was coming out with all these soul acts, he actually invented the term Neo Soul and put a trademark on it. A lot of people don't know that. So I commend his efforts, but at the same time, it's kind of perfect. Anytime an artist comes out a little bit different, oh, it's Neo Soul. Whereas back in the day, it was just good music.
Unlike other major metropolitan areas, such as New York City and its New Eurekan Poets Cafe, or Washington, D.C.'s now defunct State of the Union, Philadelphia's underground art scene has rarely had one destination spot where audiences can be assured of a cutting-edge open mic opportunity. In the mid-90s, when Philadelphia's music and spoken word scene was experiencing a resounding resurgence, there was a circuit of popular, if unlikely, venues in the downtown area where on any given night, hordes of young people would gather to experience the eclectic mix of artistic disciplines that would eventually fuel what is now known as the neo-soul sound. The Last Drop Coffee House, with its Wednesday night DJ and freestyle sessions. The Music Room, a retail store that opened its doors for live poetry and music events. The Arts Bank Cafe, where extemporaneous poetry and dance performances were common occurrences most weekends. Media Bureau, an old warehouse converted into both office and performance space during the dot-com boom by a technology firm with a keen appreciation for dance and hip-hop music. Wilhelmina's, a decadently appointed lounge where Tuesday night jam sessions gave Philly audiences their first real glimpse of rising talents like Bilal and Music. Panoramic Poetry at October Gallery, one of the East Coast's leading dealers of black visual art. And Cafe 3801, where a young Jill Scott hosted weekly jam sessions called Words and Sounds that would eventually inspire the artistry behind and the title of her debut CD.
Y'all ready to settle down and get with this? You know, settle into this feeling? Because you know it's a lot of love here.
Love. Perhaps the vehicle with the deepest overall impact among the 20-something multicultural audience were the many events promoted by a company called Buttermilk Worldwide. The brainchild of three young men who met during an internship at a local radio station, Buttermilk promoted an organic approach to performing arts without the gloss and pretense of commercial radio. For years, Buttermilk successfully merged the high energy of a DJ dance set with the mellow vibe of the poetry and soul music crowd. Their following was intensely loyal, and their stage catapulted many budding performers out of the shadows and into our national consciousness.
I think, you know, of course I can only answer from my perspective, from you know, the little bit of time that I've had to be able to enjoy it. Buttermilk itself, I think, was one of the most creative conglomerates, if you will, that came together to showcase the wonderful talents that are out there, specifically those that were here in Philly, but of course they crossed across the board. And they incorporated not only the musical aspects of things and spoken word aspects of things, but they also brought in comedy. And one of the things that I always will attribute to Def Comedy Jam was the peanut butter jam, which is created by Buttermilk. They were the first people that I knew that did a live comedy showcase. Notwithstanding yourself, people that performed at Buttermilk events, of course, Jill Scott, Chipita Mason, DJ Rich Medina, who is now ultra big, and of course I mentioned DJ Cool Marv, who is now spinning worldwide.
Yeah.
I got a CD from him that he just did the close of, what's the HBO show about the jail?
Oz.
Oz. Uh-huh. Yeah, he just did their rap party. He did a party for NBA All-Star Weekend. One of the Budweiser What's Up guys, Fred Thomas, mm-hmm. you know, has done great things. So I think that Buttermilk has had an intricate, their thumb on the pulse, if you will, of what we consider neo-soul, which is not just music. Mm-hmm. It encompasses, as you mentioned, dance, spoken word, comedy to a certain degree, and also a philosophical view of how urban, I want to say just African Americans, but how urban young people are viewing our world and society today. So, you know, if you're talking about Buttermilk, that's going to be the first thing that I think of. They were the first people that brought me into the light of what is, quote unquote, neo soul.
Another highly influential venue in the early 90s Philadelphia underground art scene was the Po Jazz Connection, a multi-generational gathering where young spoken word artists and elder musicians found an easy kinship, hosted by the Arpeggio Jazz Ensemble.
Okay, well, I feel very privileged in the sense that I was able, again, not to start anything new, because there's nothing new about poetry and jazz, But what is somewhat new is the influx of so many young people coming into the mix with poetry and jazz. Not everybody with beards and sipping espresso anymore. It's a lot of young, vibrant people who are saying, hey, I like this connection. And that's partly due to the whole rap scene. Because rap is poetry to me. Music is poetry. So I feel very, again, privileged that I was able to, one night at Zanzibar Blue, when Wadu, the poet, came up to me and said, hey man, do you mind if I do something with your music? And when that happened, it just opened up a whole bunch of stuff. And again, the brothers at Zanzibar, the Bynum brothers, said, look, what you got is cool, but why don't you take it into a separate room? And so that was the birth of the Po Jazz Connection back in 94, January, at the old Zanzibar Blue. And since then, it's been rolling. And I feel good about it because I've learned a lot. I never knew, first of all, that the poet community in Philly was so strong. That first Po Jazz night, I couldn't believe it. I was expecting we'll get maybe 20 people up there, you know. I couldn't believe it was SRO. And they were still trying to come up. The fire marshal could have closed the joint down. But it was beautiful. And it just opened my eyes as an artist and as an entrepreneur to what was like really happening in the city.
Like myself and you would ask these very same people who would propose these questions to us in some kind of quote-unquote intellectual format. So what do you think about the blah blah blah? Well, I don't. I live there. This is my house. What do you mean, what do I think about it? That's a door. That's a refrigerator. This is a chair. This is where I live. What the fuck do you think about it? You know, that's a better question. And all of that to say that I think that because of media influence, the labeling desire is a little out of control right now. And, you know, neo soul falls under that umbrella.
What is it about Philadelphia that made it the natural choice to be the national seat for this acclaimed neo soul sound?
Philadelphia has a rich history of being involved with contemporary music since the 60s and with the sound of Philadelphia and Gamble and Huff. So I think it's only natural that, you know, that things sort of start to boil again once here.
Well, it seems to be something in the water, as they say, or something in the hoagies, or something in the pretzels. But because this particular music is just one of many types of music that seems to get its innovations in Philadelphia. Even though bebop was considered to have started in New York at Mittens in Harlem, it still kind of got nurtured by a lot of Philadelphia cats. Dizzy Gillespie from Philadelphia, you see? So Philly has a history, a rich history of being innovative in the music. Sure, Detroit had Motown, but we had the Philly sound. And that sound is still strong today.
I think Philadelphia is one of those places where it's a conservative city, and black people in the city is conservative. They are conservative, but they don't realize they're conservative. They think they're hip. You see what I'm saying? And because of that, what happens is all the cats who are stepping to the left get pushed underground. They push everybody underground, it's different. And when you got a place that pushes everybody underground, what's going to happen? It's going to get crowded. People is going to just be smoldering, and it's going to blow up. And when it happens, it does. It comes like boom. When Philly hits, it hits hard. And then you ain't going to hear from Philly for a while because it's going to go back to just recreating that underground again. And then it's going to hit you again hard. It's always been like that in Philadelphia.
You got to work hard in Philly. And me personally, I like that. I like the fact that on Monday, people give you a couple props, but on Tuesday they expect you to show and prove again. And I think that from an outsider's point of view, a so-called outsider's point of view on Philly, my experience is very rich because my insights are in comparing to different places I've had the opportunity to travel. And Philly is, there's nothing like this city. It's super unique.
It started way before 5 years ago. I think that people here really started something a long time ago, and it just started coming to fruition. I think people started to recognize. People started getting tired of the music that we have to live with, this canned and forced on us today. I mean, why wouldn't you want to listen to a Jill Scott over an Ashanti? I mean, it only makes sense. And the music that we're force-fed these days, you know, is... it's so fabricated, you know. It's all pretty girls and glossy dudes, and there's no substance to it. And that's never what black music was about. That's never what music was about.
I think Philadelphia has always been an extremely musical city and an extremely culturally based city. I mean, the only reason it's gotten as much attention as it has is because it's one of the founding cities in the country. So therefore, folks know a lot about Philadelphia, but when you go past the historical ramifications and all that means from back then, you know, from rock to pop to soul to rap, Philadelphia has always represented a very deep chamber of the musical environment in the United States, whether music was coming from here, or being pioneered here. Whatever the case, it's always been a very musical city, so I think that its place as a hub is undeniable.
One of the best things I think Philly has is proximity. To be so close to New York, Atlantic City, Baltimore, D.C., Philly has great proximity. But, you know, of course, I mean, a rich tradition and music and different idioms, whether it's jazz, R&B, you know, of course, the Philadelphia sound. So I think culturally and artistically, this area is conducive to have it happen, you know. And I think because it is that type of environment, people believe in themselves. And I think right now, you have a lot of people that see other people doing it, you know. I want to say to a degree, maybe push each other, or maybe bring each other along might be a better way to put it. But I think there's a definitely an element that people see it can happen here. So consequently, you have people come from other areas because they see it happening here and they want to make it happen as well. But I think Philly, you know, there's a whole lot of flavor here. People recognize the flavor and they're trying to do something about it.
I look at the whole spectrum, if you will, of the musical genre as it relates to Philadelphia. Philadelphia has a rich history in music. Billie Holiday spent some time here. Pearl Bailey lived here. Josephine Baker lived here. Trumpeter Dizzy Gillespie lived here. You know, you have to.
Paul Robeson, John Coltrane.
Nina Simone lived here. So I think that it's not that Philadelphia just happened to get on the map. Philadelphia has always been on the map. The problem is that Philadelphia doesn't get, and we don't take the credit as much as we should. And maybe because of groups like The Roots, Jill Scott, Vivian Green, and Steph Renee. You know, if it wasn't for those groups, and of course for Buttermilk as well, then maybe, you know, we're getting more publicity. But I think that we should be offended. People were saying, oh, Philly's now on the map. No, Philly's been on the map forever. I'm like you. Don't just categorize us now. Give us credit from the years past that we had.
I don't know what it is here. Maybe it has something to do with the history. But I think there is an obvious backlash from what has been pushed upon us in commercial radio. Mm. And I don't think it's an accident, the fact that the so-called new genre was born here. And I don't think it's an accident from even what, you know, I'm not familiar with Buttermilk other than what the stories you've relayed to me, but that took place and that those kind of things bore out people who tend to be in our general age group, mm-hmm. who are coming forth with this brand of music that we can relate to, one, because it's different from what we're forced to endure now on commercial radio.
Right.
And it reminds us, there's some nostalgia there, because it reminds us of some of the things that we heard when we were bobbing around our house, listening to what our parents were listening
right.
to.
It's a lot of talent, and it doesn't always have the outlet that, say, somewhere like New York or California does. So the people who are artists wind up working hard at their craft, and it winds up being, in a sense, art for the sake of art, you know? Because there's no guarantee that you'll blow up or no guarantee that you'll be in the right place at the right time. So you do it because you love it, and that makes the music better.
Gladys Knight, who said that she became an overnight sensation after 10 years. And for me, that says it all. I mean, this is nothing new here in Philly. We've been doing this for a long time. The other people, just found out about it.
I've seen you guys come down here with a poetry book, or maybe just a little melody or harmony. And 4 years later, 5 years later, 6 years later, you guys have CDs that are being distributed all around the world. So, again, tough to pinpoint a single point, but the fact that, you know, it just seems like there is this prevalent feeling that people believe it can happen. You know, they see the Jill Scotts happen, they see a Sabella doing his thing. They see a Tanya Marie Evans making things happen, you know, bringing forth workshops and trying to educate. You know, they see these people doing things, and it seems like that's the catalyst, you know, that feeling of believing it can happen.
And not to mention the fact that because the term neo-soul was something that was media generated,
if the artists themselves had called themselves neo-soul, then there probably wouldn't be as much resistance to the title. But it's something that the media imposed on these artists. And then you go back and you have people like Jill Scott, for instance, who if you ask her what she is, she'll tell you she's a poet.
You know what I mean? Because I remember when, you know, what Jill was doing, I didn't even know Jill sang. I thought, you know, she was a poet to me. I still think a poetry is off the Richter scale, you know what I mean? Yeah. So, you know, you can see Jill walking down the street any time or, you know, Will, any of them cats back in the day, and still, it's a small, and that's why the circle is small, too, in Philly, because they all kind of congregate. People who are kind of a little bit to the left, not singing the Jay-Z stuff, not doing the regular stuff.
Hi.
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 How
y'all doing? This is where I grew up. Let's see, I really don't remember when I began. I guess it don't really matter too much, does it? But these books, spending time in my space, whether it was my mother's basement or my first apartment or, you know, wherever, this has been this is my path. And I just so happen to sing. So it's good to get back to my foundation. Let us see.
What do I do? What do I do? This would be a time for a flashback. What do I do? I create, man. I create. I'm just an instrument. The creator blows the notes to me. You know. And I said that in one of my poems, and I think that's what happens, you know.
So it's a continuous line from today, 2003, back to the first time a black person, an African, either banged on a drum or yelled to his or her friend. I mean, we just communicate that way. So there's nothing new about neo-soul. This is something that has been going on for a long time, and we got to make sure that in our community that we make sure that we define different things by our own terms. Don't let anybody call it what it's not.
Well, I think the first thing to address that is the fact that there's always been an undeniable lust for American soul worldwide. No other form of music aside from African percussion or certain forms of Brazilian music, when it comes down to cultural things, cultural as in like people of color, cultural things, I don't think there's any other genre of music that's touched people the way American soul has worldwide. You know, you can't go anywhere in the United States and hear somebody singing a Salif Keita song. But you can go to where Salif Keita is from, and everybody knows Aretha Franklin. Everybody knows Marvin Gaye. So all that to lead into the notion that when you come from that foundation, there's always a certain amount of intrigue as an American artist going to a foreign country. The other thing to understand is that because we bring the music, we bring that music and that ideology to them, they have club culture. We have music culture. It's two totally different things. You know, and they say you never miss your water until your well runs dry. So if all the soul music that was being made around here was suddenly not being made around here, I bet you the people around here would show an appreciation similar to the appreciation that the foreign folks show, because you got to go get it. You know, what if you had to take a train an hour just to get a CD and hope you got there early enough to get one of the only 100 that they're going to order? You know, put yourself there. Be that guy. And then that guy will explain to you a lot about what it is to love soul music.
Now I don't mind company, because company is all right with me every once in a while. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And what I think is great about Philly, just in terms of its uniqueness being what I would say one of the toughest cities, if you can make it in Philly, you can make it anywhere, is that the music industry now has played its card in terms of saying, okay, we have Neo Soul. And of course, we understand that it's a marketing tool, it is a business, what have you. But the greatest thing about Philly is, no matter what that world labels this thing, this energy, you still have to show and prove.
Right away. I got to make a problem. As soon as you get to go over here to this side, don't think about this leg coming over to do this, right? Think about this leg already there to begin from here, right? From here to here, right?
So, you know, I think it's good, the influence that we've had, you know, let it spread, you know, sort of like a good virus, let it get in everything, you know. Manifestation of a generation, of the expression of a specific generation, is the last thing that comes. Movement, i.e., action, is the last thing that happens. You know, music comes, gets inspired, the words happen to people. You know, people doing their thing. But when there's movement, there's action, and that's, you know, we can relate that politically with, you know, we're gonna march, or you can relate that to, I'm just feeling Marvin Gaye right now, so I need to be going, oh, you know. And that movement is a last manifestation of the collective consciousness of a generation, the way they're thinking, you know. And so that to me is everything. And it's by way we do everything. You know, we dance, by definition, walking is dancing. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. So everything we do is about worship, and that's what the movement is. The movement is worship and being in tune with our words. Words are probably the last thing you ever want to use to communicate to anyone, because you're always trying to search for words to try to explain yourself and so on. It's in your actions that people, you know, are, you know, you communicate through the action. You know, the tables turn, all the MCs are in the front, the dancers are in the front. You know what I mean? I feel a little special about that, because they still never get the dancers, the hip-hop dancers, any kind of props, because it was the hip-hop dancer, also the dancer, period, makes a lot of the show. Your rhymes are dope. But they're gonna be like, Dad, you know your dancers from so-and-so, you know so-and-so dancers, you know, in their own right. And then, you know, the cats get in the back, they get to do the backup thing, man, forget backup. But we never was about backup. We was all sharing in traditional culture. We was rhyming, rapping, emceeing, and doing the rap all together. There was no one, you know, in the circle, there's no hierarchy. In linear culture, in Euro America, white America, is a linear, which is, has this kind of structure, which suggests a line, and a line suggests hierarchy, first, second, third, fourth, fifth, and sixth, and last. You know what I mean? In the circle, there was no hierarchy. The rhymer was no more important than the dancer or the DJ. You know what I mean?
For a while, all the records that were coming out had everybody on them. And that was on the hip-hop side. You know, I mean, whether you had, like, the Roots, they had Eve and Jill on, you know, on Things Fall Apart. Mm-hmm. On Things Fall Apart. You know, and Beanie Siegel was on that record too. Now, for that to happen today, I don't know that it could. There would be, it's just way too much drama. You know, there's way too much ego involved, as opposed to, wow, you know, that song is incredible, let me put some keys on that. Wow, that, you know, that melody is crazy, can I write something to that? That doesn't happen anymore. We don't have these places where, you know, where you have these big melting pots of music anymore. There's no jam sessions anymore where, you know, hey, you know what, I'm going to go down to the club tonight, you know, because I heard Quest is going to be on drums and I just want to try something new with them. You know, it's like, well, if you're not part of this clique, you're not getting on stage. And if you don't know these cats, you can't even talk to them and you might not get in.
you know, and it became such a political fiasco, and I'm trying to speak without calling anybody out, so please forgive my elusiveness. but it's crazy, you know, when you don't have that kind of energy anymore, you know, whereas that's where the great music always came from collaborations, you know, from people working together, and your strength and my strength makes us both strong, as opposed to divisiveness that's going on these days. I mean, and it's, I hate to sound really negative about it, but to me, it bothers me, because I've been in music a long time, and I've loved music for a long time, and I see how the music is not growing where it should be growing.
Yeah, I believe that. Yeah, Philadelphia is cliquish in that way. But that's still what makes it strong. It's still what makes it strong, because when those people like become cliques, then it's still one person over here who's not in that clique, who's walking different, talking different, doing his own thing. And that's the person you want to watch. Everyone else is following. They following. They, hey, what's the day? Like the Wiz, today's color is like red. Everybody, well, yeah, I'm in red today. That's the clique, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. But that's what's, it's all relative. We have to have that in order to see this one genius that's standing to the right.
This is still my poetry voice. Okay, should I go on?
Yes.
Oh. My caucasoid freakazoid. My platinum blonde phenomenon. Being with you is like being in a big house late at night when Massa ain't home. Your skin more whiter than my malt liquor beer foam. Your flesh the shade of loose leaf without the blue and red lines. I'm showing my affection. Your milky white complexion sure enough put a whipping on my mind. All the love that I got is on an auction block. I'm so sick of playing the field. My American dream, vanilla ice cream queen. You remind me of Ollie McBeal. My Aryan humanitarian, my Marsha Brady lady, get naked with me, oh how happy we'll be, we'll have pretty little Tiger Woods babies. Let's wiggle on my waterbed, my little white bread chicken head, my love spouting fountain from the Caucasus Mountains, the flatness of your buttocks got me so hype I'm shouting. My Joan of Arc on the trailer park, my Sharia Moore, you're so white and pure, it smells like potpourri when you fart. I know you will respect me, Becky. With you I'd be lucky, Buffy. Mandy, you're sweeter than cotton candy. I love it when your thin lips touch me. See, you got the kind of looks men would burn crosses for. Cut off a nigga's nuts and display it in a general store. At one time, saying this would have violated US laws, I would dangle from a tree like a Christmas ornament just for hinting that I wanted to get into your drawers. My lily white suburbanite. Stereotype professional athletes tend alike. My 4th of July firecracker. Snow White Sleeping Beauty I've been chasing after. Clam chowder, pink baby powder. How can this be wrong? You and I got the jungle fever like Faye Ray had for King Kong. My Beverly Hills daffodil, Norwegian cruise line concubine, supple flesh the color of a virgin's wedding dress. My funny snow bunny, let's play Sharon Sunny, my albino empress. My melanin lacking fatal attraction. Make me a member of your partridge family. Snowflake, that's all that I'm asking. Come on, boo, I'd do anything for you. There's no reason for us to be lonely. 9 out of 10 ball players can't be wrong. For you, I'd even change my name to Toby. It's in your Goldilocks that I want to play. You're the brightest star in my Milky Way. Would you please be my trophy I could put in display? So my kids can have good hair one day. Thank you.
The city of Philadelphia represents America's 5th largest commercial radio market, with an FM dial that is nearly completely saturated. Yet, in spite of the popularity of the neo-soul sound and the proliferation of progressive music generated in the Philadelphia area, corporate conglomerates have made room for only the most successful of these acts, leaving critically acclaimed but lower-budget artists scrambling for a means to be seen and heard. Refuge has come in the form of several alternative means of grassroots support, most notably from college and internet radio. Dependent more on private donations than advertising sales, these stations' playlists accommodate a much broader musical sound and the work of artists not yet signed to a major label. It is here where many of Philadelphia's megastars first earn the ear of even their local audience.
I think the role that, well, actually I know the role that we play here is that we expand people's view of what soul music is. Like, I think with this whole quote-unquote term neo-soul, it's kind of pigeonholed the sound. And if it doesn't sound like this, then it's not soul music. Soul music encompasses a lot of things. Like, there's rock and roll that's considered, that's an extension of a form of soul music. Drum and bass is a form of soul music. So it's kind of like I don't know how it's come to be this way, but we've kind of cut off a lot of peripheral things with soul music and said, this is soul music. And we forgot from whence we came, where soul music was diverse. It didn't have to be a slow song with a deep bass track on the background. So I think whereas the other stations, you know, they play a certain kind of commercial soul music, which is fine, but here we play the whole diaspora of what soul music is. And a lot of people out there have been exposed to it. And I think that's why people keep the block here every Sunday, because they can hear the whole experience as to what soul music is. I get a lot of calls like, I've never heard that kind of music. And it's great because it's really opened their mind as to what real soul music is.
It's 10:42. My name is J. Michael Harrison. The show, it's entitled The Bridge. It is your bridge between bebop and hip-hop, kind of an eclectic mix of funk and jazz and poetry and acid jazz and a little bit of this and maybe even a little bit of that. And we do this and that every Friday from 10 p.m. until 2 a.m. So that means we do have a lot of show left to go. That's a good thing. But you know, college radio and public radio, that's my foundation. That's what I listened to coming up, you know, besides listening to a DAS, which I thought did incredible radio, you know, when I was coming up. But the Black Experience in Music at WKDU, legendary. Diaspora at the University of Pennsylvania. And RTI was straight up the point, you know, and it was this type of radio that you heard incredible music and incredible artistry on consistently. But at the same time, I remember, you know, hearing the last poets on DAS, you know, Gil Scott-Heron regularly on DAS. So radio was a lot different. So now, I think to a large degree, it's up to college radio to help, you know, in the embryonic stages, playing a significant part. Once someone gets to commercial success, then you see commercial radio jumping in a little bit more, you know, other than certain specialty shows. But historically, and I think, you know, to a large degree now, college radio plays a big part in the developmental stages, the embryonic stages of artists, and making them available, letting people know where these people are performing and so on, and introducing them to these people, I think it plays a big part. And I think as we have seen, you know, some commercial radio has recognized, you know, that type of success and is buying into it. So hopefully it can continue to be a catalyst and spawn that type of activity with commercial radio as well. But I think at the embryonic stages, this is where it happens.
Give me my car, all alone on this trip down Montreal Boulevard. I search for a star to show me the way back into your vaults. And wherever you are, you know I'll go that extra mile for a chance to see a smile. Oh baby, 'cause love can't be like this without another kiss. So much I'm gonna miss. So far
I've come this far,
so far,
all this way hoping,
all this way,
yeah, piece of me in your heart. 'Cause it's been so hard, every night hoping,
every night,
with the fact that we might forever part.
We're face to face.
Philadelphia's place in modern musical history has been cemented not just on the strength of its onstage talent, but also because of the solid production talent behind the boards in studios that lend this neo-soul sound to artists who hail from outside of the city limits. Hitmakers Vidal and Dre from A Touch of Jazz Studios, Amir Questlove Thompson and James Poyser of the Soul Quarians, and the legendary string arrangements of Larry Gold have lent their magic to a seemingly endless string of non-Philadelphian chart toppers, including Glenn Lewis, Eric Benet, Common, D'Angelo, Lauryn Hill, Will Downing, and Aretha Franklin. This secondary wave of success was the extra push necessary to launch an entire new crop of Philadelphia stars in the late 90s and at the top of the 21st century, who had often honed their skills as background singers or musicians with the early 90s musical standouts. Artists like Aries, Jasmine Sullivan, Vivian Green, Jeff Bradshaw, Kindred the Family Soul, Victor Duplay, Ursula Rucker, Floetry, and John Legend can all attribute part of their following to the dues paying they did with Philadelphia artists in their early stages.
Question, because you know, in a lot of people's eyes, Philly's arrived. A lot of people's eyes, Philly is ground zero. So, you know, that's a great question. I was lucky enough to really get to know Weldon Irvine well before he passed away. One of the most profound things he ever said to me was that when you're the story, there's no script. You know, everything happens behind you. So, as a purist, I'd almost plead the fifth. Where I would opinionate that it's gonna go is that more artists are gonna begin to get that fast visual acclaim within the market. You know, a la your Beanie Siegels, your Freeways, your Eves, and the artists who are rocking it and rocking it on the commercial side of the game. You know, the more proteges they bring up, the more lifeblood there is at the base of the you know, what's left, you know, of the rap aspect of hip hop culture. So I see that going in a positive direction. As for the singers and the musicians, I mean, they're always the crux. The crux of everything, you know. Rap is the newest thing out of all of it. As rap as a craft that you do to make a living is the newest of them. So the singers and musicians is going to keep on blasting, and the churches is going to keep on churning out these young cats that can really rock their particular acts, whether it be keyboards or drums or whatever, that take it into the secular world and eat off it. That's going to continue. That ain't going nowhere. It's only getting more and more and more. You know?
So anyway, I see in the future young black men and young black women being able to do their thing in terms of expressing themselves artistically without any restriction.
I'd say I'd like to hope that there is, we talked about cliques. I'd like to hope that there's more of a the cross-fertilization, cross-pollinization thing continues to happen. You know, I mean, the name of this show, I call it the bridge between bebop and hip-hop for a reason, you know, and I want younger cats to be aware of what some of the older cats have done and are doing, and older cats and kittens to be aware of what younger cats and kittens are doing and maybe come together, you know. So I'd like to see more of that activity happening on a consistent basis. I'd like to believe that you're going to see more of that. I think Philadelphia is very hot. I think there's a lot of people within Philadelphia and outside of Philadelphia that have their eyes on Philadelphia and want to come to Philadelphia and make things happen, not just on the music front, but I'd like to believe that you're going to see more of that activity.
So a lot of integration between those arts and some of the people that have, for lack of better words, paved the way recently, the Jills, the Bilals, the Musics, the where, you know, all these people, especially some of those that we know. Like, we know Jill is super multi-talented, so it's exciting to see how, what she might get into. So those types of things. seeing how we balance this whole music industry relationship with the places and spaces that we've come from and that nurtured us in terms of artists.
I see a lot of things. I work with a lot of people. And I can only hope and try to put what I like to call my positive influence, and that's just my take on it. It might not be so positive, but I like to try to put my influence on people to work together. I like to try to bring some of my clients together so they can do things, you know, in collaborative efforts, you know, because it benefits everyone, you know. So but I can't honestly say that everyone's going to feed into it. I really can't say. So I don't know. I mean, and I really hope that, you know, that the mentality that a lot of people have around here changes, and I think that it will. You know, it's real tough out here these days, you know, and working together is always better than working apart. And I think that people don't really understand the fact that, you know, sharing, you know, taking half of $100 is way better than taking all of five. You know, and a lot of people don't really get that anymore. You know, it's all about egos, it's all about challenges, and I'm hoping that changes, but I can't really say. I know that there are people who are making progressive efforts to make sure that we do remain family. There are people who are making progressive efforts to make sure that all of us get to, you know, have some fun, make some music, make some money, and just leave a mark on the world. So I'm positive. I'm remaining positive. I think something good is going to happen.
And for me, you know, I'm kind of selfish. I'm a cat that says, what if we take, you know, Black Thought and pair him with, you know, Doc Gibbs and, you know, call up Stanley Clark and ask him to fly over and, you know, call Phoebe Snow, you know, and say, let's just do something, you know. So for me personally, I would love to see that type of thing continue to happen. And really, I'm just hoping that can happen. I think that can happen.
But I think there has to be something claimed where the artists have to acknowledge themselves and to the public and be acknowledged by others that, look, we have something that's different here.
Right.
Acknowledge the fact that this is different and that as a group, we're producing some fantastic things. So if you don't want to call it Neo Soul, something needs to go this way so that people can say that is good.
Right.
And people need to acknowledge that and the people who fall within that group so that you don't accidentally say, you know, Jill Scott, The Roots, and Jay-Z in the same sentence. That has to be separated.
The main thing is that we keep putting out good music and we keep trying to be as creative as possible and be true to that and not let the term define what you do or how you do it, because then you can wind up being a parody of yourself. You wind up, you know, trying to fit the mold as far as for instead of trying to just express yourself freely. You know, you get trapped, you know. But if anything, I think the influences that, you know, that sort of fanned out, you know, Eric Benet coming here and having this production done here, James Poyser, who's a genius, and Damon Bennett, who's a genius, and ladies say he's sexy. I don't know. But that's the rumor.
And that's why I encourage everybody, just keep at it, no matter what. Maybe it didn't happen right then, but don't stop. Because that's the only certain thing. If you stop, it definitely won't happen.
The Loch Ness Monster, the Abominable Snowman, Bigfoot, and the Blair Witch all hang in the same clique. They're just myths. Fiction, tabloid weapons of mass deception, or, at their most innocent, merely figments of overactive imaginations. And here's a new one for the collection. Neo Soul. What is it exactly? Its origin and definition mysterious, but the media tells us that its epicenter's located in Philly. Really? That's news to the folks who live here. the ones who've been singing, writing, dancing, rhyming, birthing their works here since before. Letting their inspiration seep deep down into the soil that the younger generation has trod upon and sprung from, blooming beautifully. Neo soul. This vibe is new to who? You? Well, maybe it's time we Sankofa. Take you back to bring you forward. Show you there ain't nothing new in the sound of Philadelphia. We just revised some long-lasting flavor to make it fresh for y'all. Please take those irrelevant labels and erase them from your vocabulary. It ain't about what you call it. It's about the full spectrum of what your senses perceive. The sights, the sounds, the movement, and the craft of this thing. Philly's giving you something you can feel. Our artistic expression is as individual as snowflakes, natural, beautiful, and real. Don't dilute our contributions with unnecessary prefixes that attach less significance to their meaning. We're your connection to eternity, yet you call us Neo Soul. Open your eyes to the truth.
It is no such thing.